उपाध्याय प्रेसिडेंट साहब, सेक्रेटरी साहब, मिस्टर आईपी सिंह सीनियर एडवोकेट, मिस्टर अतुल वर्मा, माय फ्रेंड्स एट द बार, माय सीनियर्स एट द बार, आई हैड व्हेन आई केम टू लखनऊ आई हैड सजेस्टेड द प्रेसिडेंट साहब की लेट अस स्टार्ट एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑफ से 20-25 एडवोकेट्स हु कैन ब्रिंग इन टू लाइट द अवध बार एसोसिएशन एज एन एकेडमिक बॉडी ऑल्सो. I had suggested on the lines like the way Madras Bar High Court Association keeps on filing petitions touching upon the constitutional aspects, challenging the vagaries, so on and so forth. So let us constitute a team of 20-25 advocates who can devote their time, and if they file petitions raising the issues which are to be raised but are generally not being raised, so it will be good for the Awadh Bar Association in terms of their academic flavor. I did not know that I was falling into a trap. The trap, I'll tell you, I'll start this keynote address with a caveat that probably the President Sahab and the Secretary Sahab did not know. I have never in my life as a career as a lawyer argued an anticipatory bail application. And never as a judge I have decided an anticipatory bail application. So please bear with me with this caveat. I have had the occasion to sit on bail matters. This is also probably the first time I am sitting on the bail jurisdiction. My understanding of this whole bail jurisprudence is, the genesis is twofold. One, the freedom is guaranteed under the Constitution. Second, presumption of innocence, which is the basis for any criminal jurisprudence. You are presumed to be innocent unless proved otherwise. Now, once the freedom is being taken away in the form of arrest, in the form of detention, in the form of so many other forms, then the state has to justify why they are trying to take away your freedom. The power to arrest is specified under Section 41. There is no absolute power of arrest. The power of arrest has to be justified. It is not supposed to be in CRPC that as soon as an FIR is lodged, arrest is imminent. It has happened. We are at fault because of this. The arrest has to be justified based upon the conditions which are prescribed under Section 41. The conditions for arrest basically correlate. You can correlate the conditions for bail and the condition for arrest. The state has to justify that the arrest is needed for A, B, C, D reasons. Major being that you can flee away from the justice, you will not cooperate with investigation, it is difficult to investigate the crime without the custodial interrogation, and so on and so forth. Now, anticipatory bail in that context is basically a right which flows from Article 19 and 21. It just ensures that those rights cannot be taken, right to freedom is not taken away by the state unless the conditions so exist to do so. Now, the conditions being that you are likely to be arrested, there is an FIR against you. FIR can be 100,000 reasons. It can be political vendetta, it can be a personal vendetta, it can be a dispute which is not a reason, and the criminal machinery misuse is rampant, we all know it. So we have to just show, or the state has to show, that without the arrest of this person, investigation or trial is not possible. Unfortunately, the burden is shifted to the accused. The burden should be on the state to justify the arrest. The other thing that I have noticed is, I was under the impression bail is a rule, jail is an exception. That was the law. Now we have incorporated the principles of CPC into the bail jurisprudence, that prima facie case, balance of convenience, irreparable hardship, that needs to be rectified somehow. And the bar has to do it. We, as the judges, have very limited role to play in that, But unless the bar rises to the occasion, the kind of criminal jurisprudence that we are seeing is contrary to what was intended, the criminal jurisprudence was intended to be. Our jails are full of under trial prisoners. Pre-trial detention, under trial detention is something which is bad for a democracy. It's not a good thing. You convict a person, put him in jail. It's all right. But pre-trial detention should be justified by the state in a very, very stringent manner, which is not happening. I had read a report which says India is the second country after North Korea in the ease of putting a person behind bar. That goes contrary to what India stands for. Our constitution cherishes freedom of the best possible extent. Now that is being denied, and that is how we are reflected very poorly outside the world, to the outside world. Arrests are happening for non-payment of contractual dues. Arrests are happening because of something that has happened on a commercial level. Arrests are happening for people not drawing the line which a particular dispensation may want you to. Now these things reflect very poorly. I ask a question to myself, suppose I have to invest in say Uganda or Tanzania, will I do it? The answer probably would be no, because I know that the criminal jurisprudence or the justice delivery system there is not a well developed system. Now do we want to communicate to the entire world that our criminal justice system or the judicial system is so faulty that nobody can be guaranteed of his freedom in India? I'm sure certainly people, we do not want that to happen. Therefore, anticipatory bail I see as a matter of right unless the state justifies the arrest for reasons which are akin to what is provided under Section 41. This is the common thread from which we should develop all the arguments, and that is how it's supposed it should be. Coming to the second part of my suggestion that I have given to Mr. Chaudhary, I'll just give an example. There is a judgment of Nikesh Tarachand Shah in which the conditions provided under Section 45 for grant of bail were very stringent. The twin conditions were to be satisfied before a bail can be granted. One, that the magistrate or the presiding officer should come to a conclusion that he has not committed the offence. Second, he should form an opinion that if he is released on bail, he will not commit it again. Generally, we have found a way out that if there are no criminal antecedents, the second part can be met. But the intent of the statute is such that no magistrate, no judge in his normal head can ever predict that this man will not commit the same offence again. Therefore, the conditions are almost impossible to be performed if they are taken literally. Now, in that case, the judgment has already been, it has been declared as ultra-vires. Similar provisions exist in so many statutes. Unfortunately, we have not challenged them. They need to be challenged. Therefore, I just wanted a think tank of 20-25 lawyers. Please challenge these issues in the name of our Bar Association. That will take us places. That will give us so much of a respect that at present we need also. Bar Association has its whole role to function, the welfare of advocates, everything is there. But somehow we need to enhance our image on an India scale that we are an academic body also. I suggest that we do some action on that part. This is a formal part. I have very categorically admitted Mr. Verma is an expert on anticipatory bail. Mr. I.B. Singh, they have all spoken very well. Nothing remains to be spoken. All the judgments they have already cited. I don't think I need to cite them because they are there to study. Gurbakh Singh or Agarwal's judgment letters. But I suggest that we do an interaction on an informal basis. And where we see these are the issues which are coming forward and we need to address them and tackle them on a judicial plan. I suggest that we all body, I will be very happy to be a part of it if associated. And thank you so much for calling me. I'm so sorry if you are disappointed.